What's going on, family? It's your boy, H-U-R-U, the Great, and this is NBA History. After Joe Biden's horrible debate against Donald Trump and his failed attempt to reassure the DNC that he's the nominee to beat Donald Trump, the Democratic shields in the mainstream media has been on a disinformation initiative campaign to reassure the black community that Joe Biden is the only one to save democracy. And if anyone says any different, then they're a Russian bot or a Trump MAGA Republican extremist. The shit in this article is so hilarious that they listed the Breakfast Club. First of all, anybody in the black community knows that the Breakfast Club is an undercover Democratic platform. But I digress. Let's hop into this article and see the shenanigans. The headline starts off with "Influencers and popular podcasts fuel election disinformation among black voters, report shows." Then they display a picture of Candace Owens, knowing that she does not speak for the black community. She is Caribbean and married to a white Jewish man. Let's just stop it. And the article was written June 25th, 2024 by Marquise Francis. According to Mr. Francis, at least 40 million Americans may be regularly targeted and fed disinformation within black online spaces by a host of sources across social media fuel false information around the election, according to a new news report published Tuesday. Then he goes on to say, touted as the first deep dive into understanding disinformation targeting black Americans, the report published by Onyx Impact, a nonprofit organization working to combat disinformation within the black community, identifies half a dozen core online networks reaching or targeting black Americans online with false and misleading narratives. Conservative commentators like Candace Owens are among the most influential distributors of false information, according to the report, followed by a variety of sources such as platforms geared towards the black manosphere like the Fresh and Fit podcast. Some episodes of the show have outright challenged women's intelligence and allow guests to share false and harmful narratives without pushback. First of all, before I continue, I would like to point out the fact that the platforms that this article started off naming are not representatives of the black community. These are first and second generation immigrants that look black or have dark skin and do not share the same values of foundational black Americans, also known as freemen, Negroes, free people of color, and slaves within the historical context of American law in history.
It just so happens that a lot of black people are still right. I spew anti-stupidity. That's
no,
what
no,
I
no.
Spew.
You are an anti-black
it
racist.
It just so happens that a lot of black people are stupid.
Well, sir,
that's what I spew.
If we're so damn stupid, you're the one who fled from your damn homeland.
No, no, no.
So
I said a
stupid.
Lot of them are stupid. It
all
could be
right.
White,
well,
black, Hispanic.
You
it doesn't
from
matter.
Stupidity. We're stupid
all
enough to not
stupid.
Have to flee.
All
we're
people are stupid. See how you're going
stupid
for that hominem?
You can't say that.
See how you're going for that hominem that has nothing to do with the debate?
Sir,
that has nothing to do with the debate.
Yes, it does. Because
no, it does not.
You're not qualified
no,
to say
not.
Anybody's stupid and you fled from a
oh.
failed homeland.
Okay, so
you're not qualified.
So if someone's an immigrant, they're not qualified to comment on
no, you're
issues.
Not. If you come from a homeland where everybody's over there starving, you can't say none of us are stupid. You're not
okay.
at liberty to do that,
you,
okay?
So hold on. So let me just get this straight. Are
Let's
you
get
telling
it straight.
Me,
uh-huh.
Are you telling me that
yeah.
if you're an immigrant, you cannot comment
from
on
the
other
Sudan?
Situations.
Yeah, if you're from the Sudan, you can't say shit about a foundational black American. Nothing
interesting,
at all.
Interesting,
nothing.
Interesting.
Let yeah,
me, okay.
Nothing. You can't say
so
nothing about us.
Let's use your logic.
Not one
then.
Word.
Let's
you
lose
come
your logic.
From a failed homeland where people are starving. You can't say shit
cool.
about us. Yes.
Cool.
That's how that works.
Also, this organization, Onyx Impact, located in Atlanta, Georgia, was created by an immigrant named Iosa Osa, and it was founded in 2023. That's why I kind of understand why the author of this article made the statement of they are touted as the first deep dive into understanding disinformation targeting black Americans. Meaning that's a claim that they make themselves and it's not proven. I thought we were supposed to trust sources with a credible history or reliable sources. This is a person straight out the boat telling us what they done heard somebody else tell them. I'm sorry to break it to you. We don't know them. They are not reliable. Okay, let's continue. The nationally syndicated radio show The Breakfast Club as a gateway influencer or an authentic online space that holds critical space for stemming the tide for disinformation. These platforms, however, are also often targets for bad actors to introduce harmful narratives, according to the report. Now, we all know what bad actors come to The Breakfast Club to try to gain an influence or a foothold within the black community. And that has been nothing but Democratic shields, tethers, and people who just want to profit off of black culture. So we're just going to chalk this part up as disinformation coming from MSNBC and their so-called reliable source. This is when it gets disrespectful and when you know that the grassroots movement is strong. Three other effective sources of disinformation the report notes are extreme black nativists and separatists, like foundational black Americans who don't believe in the concept of pan-Africanism and have stressed that people who are not descended of enslaved people should not speak for or on behalf of black Americans, as well as health skeptics such as RZA Islam and activists and self-proclaimed intellectual extremists. I'm gonna skip this part because I don't want no issues with the YouTube moderators. The CDC gives great recommendations when it comes down to health sources. And also, I'm tired of being in YouTube jail. So I will leave a link to this full article in the description and you can read it yourself. But when it comes to the part of the FBA movement, one thing I can say is that they do have the concept right. But like the black community itself, we are not a monolith. And some of us do support Pan-Africanism. Some of us support the Native American Freedmen movement. And some of us are just black and want to support our own. So saying that we don't support Pan-Africanism is somewhat false. We support black unity across the board, wherever you at. But we also understand that we are different and we come from different backgrounds and have a different historical story. Also, majority of us can trace our family past the Civil War and the American Revolution. So our history here is longer than any African nation that is created today.
Africans, we lie a lot as if we know where we're from. Most of us can't tell you two generations past where we are from. And I've had the privilege of traveling in Africa a lot as well. And my identity is ubiquitous, right? It's, nobody could tell where I'm from by looking at me. When I'm in Nigeria, they think I'm Igbo. I could go to Ghana, they think I'm Ghanaian. The average Gambian may look at me and look at us and say, you don't look Gambian. I'm just African. So, and part of the book is there's a chapter I talk about life as a hyphen where I'm African. I think I'm from the western part of Africa. That's what I identify the strongest with, is my identity as an African, but I have a Gambian cultural background and heritage.
Also, we are not separatists because we are not trying to separate from America. We are proud Americans that are just demanding what is due to us as American citizens. The report also identified foreign actors that seek to influence U.S. political discourse, like the digital media company African Stream. African Stream denies spreading misinformation, adding that they present an authentic African perspective. We have a vigorous fact-checking process, which means work is checked by three different trained journalists three times before posting on our platform. The Nairobi-based company said in a statement describing their work as a pan-African digital media platform covering affairs concerning Africans at home and in the diaspora. Onyx Impact found those six sources collectively have a potential reaching of nearly 41 million Americans, adding that each represents spaces where skepticism, anti-black rhetoric, and deception of truth run rampant. For context, that figure is equivalent to nearly every black person in the country, according to the latest census data. Over 4 months, a team of researchers from Onyx Impact identified 2,500 online accounts creating, sharing, or amplifying disinformation to black communities. These researchers also held 7 national focus groups of black audiences to understand how those narratives were showing uplift in online spaces. The point of the effort was to gauge the impact of the information, said the founder of Onyx Impact, Eosa Osa, an alumnus of the voting rights group Fair Fight. I'm gonna skip this little part about Candace Owens and the things that she has said in the past because she is a non-factor in the black community. Constant repetition of false or misleading information, no matter how kind of absurd the disinformation is, said Osa, can be effective across audience, regardless of income, education, or class. Disinformation works because the more times that we hear something, the more likely we are to believe that it is true, she said. Narratives with the highest reach of impact across the networks, the report say, include misleading narratives focused on promises that these networks say President Joe Biden has broken, civil engagement, and issues that stoke division. Okay, when it comes down to things that Joe Biden supposedly has promised to the black community and failed on, it's true. This is why he scrambled to clear the student debt for a lot of Americans. But initially, This was only intended for black Americans as an incentive for voting for him. Reason why later on this became an issue and looked upon as a broken promise, because he gave this to everyone, not only black people, and that's what we personally asked for, to hold our nose and press Joe Biden for president, even though majority of black Americans do not go to college. Critics have also repeatedly slammed the popular gossip site The Shade Room for being a hub of disinformation, particularly on issues related to Biden. The outlet once reported about a Biden-backed program to distribute crack pipes to promote health equality. The site ran with an article by the Washington Free Beacon, a conservative website. The post quickly went viral, and the White House called it misleading and misinformed. In reality, the program was a harm reduction program meant to reduce drug overdoses. The Shade Room corrected the information in a follow-up post and took the original post down. But for many, the misinformation had already spread further than the truth. The Shade Room did not respond to a request for comment. The report noted that confronting the challenges created by misinformation is critical to ensuring the health and stability of our democracy. When left unchecked, experts say disinformation can have a devastating effect on the most marginalized communities, including harming physical and mental health. First of all, I want to make this very clear. The Shade Room is a celebrity gossip website. If you go to the Shade Room for political news, then you are an idiot. You should take any information from this website with a grain of salt, because it is gossip. It is a propaganda site. Also, it is founded and ran by a Nigerian. So again, they are claiming that a platform created by immigrants has been a large source of disinformation towards the Biden campaign within the black community. See, this is how you know they are desperate, and whoever wrote this is just talking and not really involved in the black community, because majority of the black community already know that the Shade Room is a gossip site. It is what white people call a news commentary show, similar to this one. Or you could compare it to the Rachel Maddow show, reason why she won her defamation case versus the OAN network or the One America network. When the conservative news network sued her for defamation when she went on air calling them, quote, paid Russian propaganda. And she won that case by the judge ruling that people should know that her show is for entertainment purposes and is a commentary and critique show, and not actually journalism like the kind that you get with your local and national morning and late night news that's supposed to be based on only unbiased facts. In other words, the judge basically said, she just talking, you can't take everything she say serious. And finally, if we're gonna be honest, technically the Shade Room did not lie, because the White House did not deny the fact that they do have a program that they created that gives away crack pipes. They just didn't say it in a confusing, educated way where it sound appealing to the ear. The Shade Room just put it in simple, stupid form where anybody, no matter your background, you understood. They have a program giving away crack pipes, even though they claim they're trying to stop drug abuse. I don't know about you, but that don't make sense to me. They might as well just say, hey, stop doing that street crack and come over here and do this certified USDA crack. It's guaranteed to have you twitching. Let's just quit the shenanigans. Who are the ones really pushing disinformation, misinformation, or misinforming the public? Because so far within this article, it seems like Marquise and MSNBC are the ones that is misleading and misinforming the people. We have already pointed out multiple errors and misleading statements, and we're just in the middle of the article. That includes skipping a couple of parts. But I digress. But like I said before, the link to the article will be in the description. But I do want to add the fact that this is a revised version of the original article, because Marquise came back that night at 12:17 and made a correction that the Breakfast Club, according to report's criteria, the report classified it as a gateway influencer, not as an outright distributor of false information. So I guess somebody at iHeartRadio called them up and said, hey, you can't say that about Breakfast Club. You making us lose money. It got so serious that they told Marquise come on the show and go and break this down to us. And when you listen to him break it down, it just sounds like a whole bunch of Democone babble.
There is this new report out saying that tens of millions of Americans are being targeted with a ton of disinformation in online black spaces ahead of the 2024 presidential election. It highlights three significant threats to black voter engagement in November, including getting people to not care about voting or the election at all. President Biden's broken promises, real and, by the way, made up, and stoking divisions amongst black voters via certain influencers who knowingly and unknowingly spread disinformation, like, for instance, Candace Owens, who has millions of followers on various platforms. She said blatantly inaccurate things, like, by the way, vaccines cause a, quote, explosion of childhood cancer, and that the Uvalde shooter who killed 19 children was transgender. NBC's Marquise Francis just dropped a story on NBCnews.com for us and is joining us now with more on this. Break this all down for us, Marquise, if you can, and what more you found in this report.
Absolutely. Well, thank you for having me. You know, disinformation is something that people talk incessantly, seemingly, about online or in person, amongst their friends or whatnot. But they don't talk often about what is it and how is it impacting people. Mm-hmm. So this report out by Onyx Impact, touted as the first of its kind to really understanding disinformation through online black communities, and they identified half a dozen core online networks that are reaching or targeting specifically black Americans. And they named gateway influencers and platforms, far-right activists and media outlets, the black manosphere, black extreme nativists and separatists, health skeptics, and foreign actors. And they include a bunch of different examples, as you mentioned, Candace Owens just before, even the Fresh and Fit podcast. These are places that people go to for information, but when the information is not true and inaccurate, it has a devastating effect.
So, okay, we got this report. They've identified the issues. They've identified the misinformation and the problems. What can be done about it, and how much does Onyx actually think this is going to influence voters one way or the other come November?
Yeah, for sure. I mean, in this report, they actually offer strategic guidance in which to combat this. Mm. Normally, I would think, okay, you run away, right? But they're actually saying, no, engage with these platforms. They offered actually several key ways to engage. Engaging with them, not just before an election is coming up, but consistently. Also, identifying trusted messengers and discrediting bad actors, which is super important. And overall, aggressively countering that disinformation. I actually also spoke to the CEO, and she has something to say about that as well.
Black voters are likely less susceptible to many disinformation narratives, given their deserved higher levels of skepticism in institutions and government overall. But just like other communities, when disinformation is targeted and sophisticated and comes from messengers with standing, it can be incredibly effective and dangerous.
Yeah, and so this report and its findings are hoping to inform us as Americans, as, you know, people who are actively engaging in our democracy. And one of the things that I also found in my research is the fact that black Americans actually over-index when it comes to social media. In this age where everything is put behind a paywall, right, Oftentimes black Americans are getting their information from YouTube and from Facebook. And so when that information is not vetted and not actually correct, it can really have such a large impact.
So when you talk about engagement, when you talk about combating it, who's doing it? Us as citizens, all of us?
Yeah.
Black, white, brown, no matter what color, engaging in disinformation and fighting back.
Engaging and holding accountable.
Speaking of facts.
If you listen to a platform regularly and they don't do this all the time, but they have someone on that platform who is spewing disinformation, it's all of our responsibility to actually combat that and say, hey, that's not okay.
Speaking facts to truth.
Absolutely.
Truth to non-facts. Yes, got it. Okay, Marquise Francis, thank you so much.
The Democratic Party is slowly realizing that they can't rely on the black vote to save them this time. And in all honesty, I feel like they just switching to plan B, which is the same one they had in 2016, blame the black community and black men, and call everything Chinese and Russian propaganda.
There seems to be a sort of rash of videos that have been edited to make the president appear especially frail or mentally confused. I'm wondering if the White House is especially worried about the fact that this appears to be a pattern that we're seeing more often.
Yeah, and I think you all have called this the cheap fakes video, and that's exactly what they are. They are cheap fakes video. They are done in bad faith, and some of your news organization have been very clear, have stressed that these right wing critics of the president have a credibility problem because of the fact checkers have repeatedly caught them pushing misinformation, disinformation, and so we see this, and this is something coming from your your part of the world, calling them cheap fakes and misinformation. And I'll quote the Washington Post, where they wrote about this, and they said how Republicans use misleading videos to attack Biden in a 24-hour period. And to their credit, we have a conservative Washington Examiner did call them out as well, calling out the New York Post. Ironically, several recent cheap fakes actually attacked the president for thanking troops. That is what they're attacking the president for. Both in Normandy this happened, and again in Italy. And I think that it tells you everything that we need to know about how desperate Republicans are here. And instead of talking about the president's performance in office, and what I mean by that is his legislative wins, what he's been able to do for the American people across the country, we're seeing these deep fakes, these manipulated videos. And it is, again, done in bad faith.
This is really a joke and a spit in the face. Because they know legally if Joe drop out, they have to go with Kamala. Other than the Black Boule and liberal Democrats, Kamala don't have a chance in the world. Not only is she disliking the black community and has been called out multiple times for passing, we know where she stands and any other immigrant that claims to represent us because they look like us. Because when you look past the sound bites and look at the things they are doing, they do not support or share the same sentiments, descendants of American freemen, the true foundation of this country. When you look at every representative in Congress that looks black, you will discover that they are either a first or second generation immigrant, and they do not support reparations. Why? Because they know that they do not qualify. Don't believe me? Just what?
That I am not a part of the culture. I'm a observer of the culture and a sort of sometime a participator in the culture.
And when you first hear that, isn't that hard to hear?
It's hard to hear.
It's
very hard to hear.
Because that's not what you thought it was.
Right.
You felt like you were in there.
No, hearing this right now is like.
But when you call a spade, nigga, my culture is Copa and Guyot. No matter how much I love rap.
That shit hurt me, bro.
No matter how much I love rap, my culture isn't cornbread and ham hocks.
Right.
Even though I fuck with it.
But, right,
but I'm a sauce swine nigga.
Right.
You was born in Haiti or you was born here?
I'm born here.
No, we're born here.
Yeah.
But the culture and the foundation of what they stand on has already been laid before we got here,
yeah,
right? So when we come here, we get in the Jordans and we get in the thing. We watching Fresh Prince, and that's us observing the culture and then mimicking the culture to a certain degree. Right. We're not of the culture
and because we look like but them, even and because though they invite we us in to feel like here, home.
Yeah, no, even born, though, bro, this no, conversation it's, fucked it's me up, Chris.
If we focus on the specific issues that have resulted in the greatest disparities. And we understand that that's part of why we're doing it. Listen, the reality also is this. Any policy that will benefit black people will benefit all of society. Let's be clear about that. Let's really be clear about that. So I'm not going to sit here and say I'm going to do something that's only going to benefit black people. No. Home ownership is one of the best ways that we achieve intergenerational wealth. We also know that it is one of the many issues where we have seen incredible obstacles for black families. We don't even need to go as far back as nobody got the 20 acres and a mule.
Dr. King said at the tail end of his life, he said, we're going to Washington to get our check. You understand? So now, what is your position on reparations? Descendants of slaves, because we've had a lot of immigration over the last 100 years in America. Of American slavery. There was slavery in the Caribbean. The one brother came up, he
said that he's first generation of the brother in the Kango because his parents came from Jamaica. My grandmother is from Jamaica, so my grandmother is Jamaican. I know exactly what you're talking about. My mother was born in the United States. I'm born in the United States. So this is a fundamental question. You a black man, I'm a black man. Am I eligible for reparations right now? I would say the answer is no, I'm not. Because my family is from Jamaica. My father's Panamanian. His grandparents were born in Panama. My father immigrated to the United States. So does that make me eligible? So you gotta go through all of that. That's step one. Step number two, slavery under federal law was ended in 1865. The Jim Crow era ended, obviously, with the 64 Civil Rights Act, the 65 Voting Rights, etc. The fundamental question is, you've now had three generations of black people come up in the United States. Is a black kid today, does he get reparations? Third question. Hold on now. Third question. You got a lot of other people in the United States. Asians, are they responsible for the cost of the slave trade? No, because they're of Asian descent. People of Indian descent. People who are Hispanic in the United States, the largest growing population in the United States, and of course the dominant population is still the white population. But even in that, it's not just Southern whites that were plantation owners from their grandfathers, grandfathers, grandfathers. So if you're going to talk about reparations today, what you're talking about is taking money from other Americans, which quite rightly, the pain and the toil that did happen in America through slavery, through Jim Crow, but now you're asking Americans today and in the future to pay that bill. Is it that bill? Is it their bill, Americans today, to pay? I'll ask you a slightly different question, because it's not reparations. It's about Joe Biden's student loan bailout. And I'm not going off, but it's a comparison point. Two-thirds of the American people did not go to college. Is it okay for Joe Biden to say, well, we're going to forgive student loans, even though two-thirds did not go to college? It is now the debt burden of the two-thirds of the American people that did not go. I will tell you the answer is no. People may not like that, but that's the reality. And brother, I want to be respectful of you, because I understand the reparations argument. But we are now more than 150 years from the Emancipation Proclamation. We are easily 80 years from the end of the Jim Crow era. Who now? I just addressed it. I said no, and now I'm giving my answer. And here's the thing. So here's what I'm going to say. And I want to thank you for your service.
Thank you.
Because what's coming up in the room is taking you too long to answer. Oh, I'm sorry. Do you want Vice President Harris to talk about Venn diagrams and then tell you, yeah, okay, yes? Is that what we're going to do? Do you want Joe Biden to not even be able to answer your question? Because he won't get into the details of this? Because the reality is you have a lot of people who will throw out talking points because it sounds good, because they want your vote, but they're not going to do what's necessary to make sure that you're successful in this country.
Like sometimes when people are so hurt, yeah, and damaged, they go and do the other extreme thing, and it is not okay.
Agreed.
And it's not cool, but it doesn't just happen politically.
Agreed.
And I think it is irresponsible. Had stuff to say about when a Washington Post article came out about black people in Detroit not wanting to vote for Joe Biden and potentially voting for Donald Trump. That's how we end up losing engagement.
I totally agree.
Literally. Like, we're in a place now where this shit is so narrowed down and so refined and so, like, we're not engaging people anymore.
I don't receive that.
It's true. Like, look at the numbers.
I give Angela credit for admitting the truth, but it is still simultaneously disturbing because guess what? Her tears formed because she's concerned about Donald Trump taking office and not about whether or not black folks are going to receive reparations, economic justice, other forms of legal justice in terms of protections like other groups get. Will the gerrymandering stop for us? Will the redlining stop for us? Will we get true substantive criminal justice reform? She's not tripping about that. She's tripping about Donald Trump, which means she's D1 and not B1. D1 is what I call Democrat first and not B1, which stands for black first. Somehow they still think that Donald Trump, the only thing to talk about is the fact that he's a racist. Well, Joe Biden is that. Joe Biden was the mastermind behind the 94 crime that's responsible for destroying at least two generations of black folks since Jim Crow. Joe Biden has equally said public things that were anti-black and racist. Most recently when he said that America is doomed in part because of black folks and because the Europeans in the United States are going to be the minority by 2040. They let all that go. Yes, Trump is outrageous and certainly a suspected white supremacist. But the fact that they can't admit the same about Joe Biden shows us that they don't care that he's not pushing substantive black policies. They just want a friendly white supremacist in office. And that is still a problem for us.
African Americans built this nation. You built this nation. You know, you're just starting to get real credit for that. Okay, I don't know if you know that. You're just starting to get, you built the nation. We all built it. But you were such a massive part of it. Bigger than you were given credit for. Does that make sense? Right?
Oh, we're running!
How many of you know that even on today, that Donald Trump, hallelujah, he got 34 counts, and he's a felon. How many of you know that, hallelujah, that a felon really can't even supposed to be running for a president? Is that right? He really is considered a three-time loser. Hallelujah, Jesus. But in the state of New York, we showed him.
And this is why the mainstream media do not like independent news. Shout out to Vicky Dillard, Tariq Nasheed, RZA Islam, Black Alpha, Dane Calloway, Big Chief in H-Town with BCU, Afro Elite, The Black Authority, Phil from Africa Diaspora News Channel, people who are bringing truth and awareness to our community. No matter what ideology you follow, we are all about unity and coming together as one. And finally seeing true justice in America for the stolen land and unpaid labor, the legally sanctioned and unjustified elimination of our people. As long as we continue to walk in the spirit of our elders and stand strong and stay on code, we cannot be defeated.